The future of motoring is here in the form of the EV car. But after you've selected the colour, the make and model, your mind quickly drifts to what?
Well, you're going to be thinking, where do I charge it and how do I charge it to get over that range anxiety, which is a barrier for a lot of people when thinking about electric vehicles. And that gives us quite a few options, Gary, doesn't it?
Yeah, we could use the granny cable provided with the car, which plugs into a 13 amp socket outlet, but the car behind us would take an incredible amount of time to charge.
You're right, Gary, it would. That granny cable, yes, occasional use when you visit granny, but if you were visiting granny, you're going to be there a long time. This car's got a 75 kilowatt hour battery, which on that granny cable, 2 kilowatt per hour charge, means you're going to be there for nearly 36 hours. So let's hope that the cupboard is fully stocked and there's lots of tea available.
Whilst we like drinking tea here at eFIXX, it's likely that the customer's going to choose a dedicated EV charging point to charge their car.
Yeah, and in this video, we're going to look at exactly the things you should think about when choosing an EV charger so you can charge faster and safer.
The journey to owning an EV charging point starts here, where the meter's located and what we're looking for in particular.
Okay, there's two things we're interested in here. One is how much power is available from this supply. So the magic number in an ideal situation for it is 100 amp written on that fuse. It may be lower, which then brings in our second factor, Gary, and that's how much power do we use in the house as it is. You know, do we have an induction hob? Do we have an electric shower? Yeah. That makes a difference. But is that a big problem, Gary?
No, because it just means you have to select the appropriate EV charger that will allow for load sharing throughout your property. In other words, it can manage how much electricity is being used by the installation and how much the EV car can take of the leftover power.
This incoming supply here is rated at 100 amps. Now, if you have a 60 or 80 amp supply, it may be possible to get that up rated to 100 amps, which allows more capacity for charging and other electrical appliances. One thing to watch out for is the potential for a looped supply. So this means you've got a cable coming in here and a cable going out that goes to your neighbor's house. We've made a separate video about that, but beware of that because that could cause your EV installation journey to come to an abrupt halt or delay by a number of months.
Can the electrical system cope with adding another circuit to it? In other words, we're here at the consumer unit or fuse box looking to see if there's a spare fuse way for this new circuit.
Yeah, luckily, Gary, there is in this one, but that's only because we changed the entire consumer unit. Now, that may come as a surprise because this is quite a modern house, but there wasn't a spare way and the electrical system in here wouldn't cope with the requirements of an EV charger from safety and a performance viewpoint. So check out the video I've made about that to see why we went through this process.
Next thing to consider is the position of your EV charging point in relationship to where you'd like to charge your vehicle.
Yeah, now that can be a bit of a trade-off between where it's easiest to actually fit the charge point and get the cable to it and the places you could possibly charge your car. Made quite easy in this property because there's two allocated parking spaces. So apart from running the cable out of an upstairs window at the front of the house, this is the best natural location to put the EV charge point.
Another important consideration for your EV charging point is obviously the lead when it's left behind, that it doesn't become a trip hazard.
One important factor when choosing location of our EV charge point is how easy is it for the charging lead to reach the charging inlet on the car. Now remember, different cars have that in different places. So the car you buy today may be different from the car you have in 3 years' time. Or do you like to reverse in or do you like to drive in when you come home from work?
When selecting your EV charger, you'll be offered a tethered or untethered lead. But what does that mean?
Well, in simple terms, is the lead permanently attached to the charger, like this one that you've got here, Gary? Or do you have to provide your own lead that you plug into the charger? But you'll have to rescue that from the boot. Do you feel like doing that in the middle of a dark winter's night? Or would you just have the convenience of taking the lead from the wall and plugging it straight into your car? There are some other things you may want to think about before choosing those options.
So consideration needs to be for the length of this lead to make sure it can get to the appropriate part of the car.
Yeah, or you may want to think the environment in which your charger lives. This is a public area here. Is there a risk that the local children will want to play skipping ropes on your EV charging lead?
With the tethered lead, it's important that we wind it back onto our EV charger after we've used it, because there's always a chance, Gordon.
Yeah, someone could drive over it and you won't have that risk with an untethered lead because you'll be unplugging the cable, putting it in the car, and that stays with you all the time. If you're possibly renting a property out, that may not be a risk that you want to take, so you might want to go for the untethered option so the cable is not your responsibility.
And if the cable does get damaged, it's an electrician's job in order to replace that cable. I can see there that we've got a Type 2 connector for our EV charging. Is there any other types?
Yes, you used to be able to get a Type 1 on older cars, but now Most cars are coming with this type 2 connector, but it's worth bearing in mind if you're in the market for a used car that it may not have this type of connector, and that will affect your choices when it comes to your EV charge point.
We stated in the opening part of this video that if we were to plug this EV car into a standard 13 amp socket outlet, it would take up to 36 hours to charge it. So what's the advantage of using this EV charging point?
Okay, so this one behind us, Gary, will charge at 7 kilowatts, which is the maximum you can have on a UK residential supply single phase. If you want faster than that, you're gonna have to go to 3 phase, which is, I'd suggest, a significant investment to get faster charging. But with this 75 kilowatt hour battery, this will charge in just over 10 hours from empty to full.
That leads me nicely into cost. No longer are we going to be on a forecourt filling up with petrol and diesel, but we're going to see a significant increase in our electricity bills.
You're right, Gary. Obviously, a significant amount of electricity goes in to charge a car, and then people become acutely aware of how much that costs them. And that's again where the charger comes in, because this is a smart charger. Now, what you can do with a smart charger is leverage into some smart tariffs that are starting to emerge just for the EV market. I will put some links in the description to some that are dedicated for EV drivers, but some of those tariffs actually will pay you to charge your cars depending upon the time that you do it.
That seems too good to be true.
Well, there's always somebody who has to take it away when you've been given a gift. And the takeaway is, if you were trying to charge your car peak hours when everybody else is trying to cook the tea on the induction hob and take an electric shower, you will pay a premium for your energy. So this is again where the charger can help in that process. Smart chargers can be linked to your energy tariff and manage that process for you, so you can either charge at the optimum price point for you or make some decisions if you need to charge at the fastest possible rate.
If, like the property we're here at, you've got solar panels, or you're thinking about getting solar panels in the future, it's important your EV charger is also compatible with them.
You're right, Gary. So this charger here can divert the excess energy generated by the solar panels that's not being used within the property to charge the car. Now, it gives us 3 ways of doing that as quickly as possible: supplementing what power is generated by the panels with some power from the grid, or just waiting for enough solar power to be generated and putting that in the car.
So we're inside the car now. Why is it really important that when we're thinking about installing our EV charging point, that we think about connectivity to the internet?
Yeah, well, this car, Gary, has its does over-the-air software updates, and it needs a reliable Wi-Fi connection to do that. So while you're installing your EV charge point, you may also think, is it in an area where I've got a good Wi-Fi signal? And that's something, you know, you're doing some wiring in the house, you may choose to improve along with the EV charger.
We're on the subject of future-proofing. What considerations would I have to be thinking about when having a second, say, EV car?
Yeah, you're right, Gary. It's pretty easy to future-proof the car with a Wi-Fi update. It's not so easy to future-proof the electrical system unless you think about it when you take the first step to install the first EV charger. Now, there's systems on the market that will allow 2 EV chargers to share a supply and then intelligently communicate between them. So one car may charge first and then the second car charges second, or the systems can intelligently share the available power between the cars on the network. Now, that's something you may want to think about. It's easy to upgrade the electrical system if you're right next to the meter box at the front of the house. But on this installation, we worked incredibly hard to get the cable all the way through the house and out to the charge point. It would be a shame not to think of that second car option.
When choosing our EV charging point, another consideration is the looks, and I think we've selected one here that blends in beautifully with its surroundings.
Yeah, that's a personal choice, and that's this one blends in with a fence, with the other colours that are seen in the house and the houses around it. Now, there's a vast array of chargers coming to the market. Some of them look a little bit more agricultural than others. Some of them are absolutely tiny, but just remember, not all chargers have all features. So bear that in mind when you're choosing it. Is it all about the looks? Is it about the app? Is it about the safety features? Is it about combining with solar power?
You touched on safety features there, and this is a conversation you should have with your electrician. Are those safety features built within the actual EV charger itself, or are they going to need to be housed somewhere else within the installation?
Yeah, you're right, Gary. That can affect the complexity of the installation and hence the cost. Yeah, is it another box by the consumer unit, or is it a slightly larger charger that has everything built in here? Again, another choice to make.
Have we just proved there's more considerations about the EV charging point than there was in selecting the car in the first place?
You're right, Gary. It can make a massive difference to how much you pay to charge your car and that cost of motoring. If you'd like to see the steps that we went through to fit this charger, so all the way from the meter at the front of the house, running the cable through the house, lifting the floors, adding some other features, all the way to this charge point, check out the video in the eye above my head or the description below.
As always, we're interested in your comments. What sort of things do you need in an EV charging point? What considerations did you make when selecting an EV charging point? Or were some of the things that we brought up in this video things that you hadn't considered and will be considering them in the future when you're selecting your own EV charging point? We'll try and get back to as many of those comments as we can.